Now, the budget, Maniya Vitta Mantri Ji.
Madam Speaker, I rise to present the budget for the year 2018-19. Madam, 4 years ago, we pledged to the people of India to give to this nation an honest, clean and transparent government. We promised a leadership capable of taking difficult decisions and restoring strong performance of Indian economy. We promised to reduce poverty, expedite infrastructure creation, and build a strong, confident and new India. When our government took over, India was considered a part of the fragile five, a nation suffering from policy paralysis and corruption. We have decisively reversed this. The government led by Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi has successfully implemented a series of fundamental structural reforms. With the result, India stands out as amongst the fastest growing economies in the world. The journey of economic reforms during the past few years has been challenging but rewarding. As a result of the reforms undertaken by the government, foreign direct investment has gone up, measures taken by the government have made it easier to do business in India, natural resources are now allocated in a transparent and honest manner, there is a premium on honesty. Ek samay tha jab bhrashtachar shishtachar ka ang ban gaya tha, aaj hamare nagrik विशेष रूप से नवयुवक वर्ग ईमानदारी का जीवन व्यतीत करने को तत्पर है। द इनडायरेक्ट टैक्स सिस्टम विद द इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द गुड्स एंड सर्विसेज टैक्स हैज बीन मेड सिंपलर। बेनिफिट्स टू द पुअर हैज बीन टारगेटेड मोर इफेक्टिवली विद द यूज ऑफ डिजिटल टेक्नोलॉजी। द डीमोनेटाइजेशन ऑफ हाई वैल्यू करेंसी हैज रिड्यूस्ड द क्वांटम ऑफ कैश करेंसी इन सर्कुलेशन। It has increased the taxation base and spurred greater digitization of the Indian economy. The insolvency and the bankruptcy code has changed the lender-debtor relationship. The recapitalized banks have now a greater ability to support growth. All these structural reforms will help the Indian economy achieve stronger growth in the medium and long term. Indian economy has performed very well since our government took over in May 2014. India achieved an average growth of 7.5% in the first 3 years of our government. Indian economy is now a $2.5 trillion economy, seventh largest in the world. India is expected to become the fifth largest economy very soon. On purchasing power parity basis, we are already the third largest economy. Indian society, polity and economy have shown remarkable resilience in adjusting with structural reforms. The GDP growth at 6.3% in the second quarter signaled a turnaround of the economy. We hope to grow at 7.2 to 7.5% in the second half. The IMF in its latest update has forecast that India will grow at 7.4% next year. Manufacturing sector is back on the growth path. The services, which is the mainstay of our growth, have also resumed their high growth rate at 8% plus. Our exports are expected to grow at about 15% in 2017-18. We are now firmly on course to achieve a high growth of 8% plus. We have taken up programs to direct the benefits of structural reforms and good growth to reach the farmers, poor and other vulnerable sections of our society to uplift the underdeveloped regions. This year's budget will consolidate these gains and particularly focus on strengthening agriculture and rural economy, provision for good health to economically less privileged, taking care of senior citizens, infrastructure creation, and working with the states to provide more resources for improving the quality of education in the country. The Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi, has always stressed the importance of good governance. He has articulated the vision of minimum government and maximum governance. This vision has inspired government agencies in carrying out hundreds of reforms and policies, rules and procedures. This transformation is reflected in the improvement of India's ranking by 42 places in the last 3 years in the World Bank's ease of doing business, with India breaking into the top 100 for the first time. I would like to congratulate all those who worked to achieve this. Hamari Sarkar ab ease of doing business se aage badhkar desh ke jan samanya, visheshkar gareeb aur madhyam varg ki zindagi ko aasan banane ke liye unki ease of living pe zor de rahi hai. Good governance ka aadhar bhi yahi hai ki desh ke aam nagarik ke jeevan mein sarkari dakhal kam se kam ho. Ujwala yojana ke madhyam se सरकार देश के करोड़ों गरीबों को मुफ्त गैस कनेक्शन दे रही है. सौभाग्य योजना के जरिए 4 करोड़ घरों में बिजली कनेक्शन से जोड़ा जा रहा है. 3000 से ज्यादा जन औषधि केंद्र में 800 से ज्यादा दवाइयां कम कीमत पर बेची जा रही हैं. स्टेंट की कीमत नियंत्रित की जा रही गई है. गरीबों को मुफ्त डायलिसिस सुविधा के लिए विशेष योजना शुरू की गई है. गरीबों और मध्यम वर्ग को आवास योजनाओं की ब्याज दरों से बड़ी राहत भी दी गई है. सरकारी सेवाएं, चाहे बस ट्रेन का टिकट हो या कई तरह के प्रमाण पत्र, सभी ऑनलाइन उपलब्ध करने का प्रयास किया जा रहा है. 2 से 3 दिन के भीतर घर पे आ जाने वाला पासपोर्ट हो या 1 दिन में रजिस्टर होने वाली कंपनी, इससे देश के बड़े वर्ग को लाभ पहुंचा है. सर्टिफिकेट अटेस्टेड कराना की बाध्यता खत्म करना और ग्रुप सी व डी की नौकरियों में इंटरव्यू खत्म करना के लिए न जाने लाखों नौजवानों के समय और पैसे की बचत हुई है. ये सरकार अनावश्यक नियम कायदों के साथ संघर्ष कर रहे हर व्यक्ति को आधुनिक तकनीकी का उपयोग करते हुए राहत देने के लिए प्रतिबद्ध है. मैडम, व्हाइल अंडरटेकिंग दीज रिफॉर्म्स एंड प्रोग्राम्स, वी हैव वर्क्ड सिंसियरली एंड विदाउट वेइंग द पॉलिटिकल कॉस्ट. Our government has ensured that the benefits reach the eligible beneficiaries and are delivered to them directly. Many services and benefits are being delivered to the people at their doorsteps or in their accounts. It has reduced corruption and the cost of delivery and has eliminated the middlemen in the process. The direct benefit transfer mechanism of India is the biggest such exercise in the world and is a global success story. Agriculture and rural economy. My government is committed to the welfare of the farmers. For decades, the country's agricultural policy and programs has remained production centric. We had sought to effect a paradigm shift. The Honorable Prime Minister gave a clarion call to double the farmers' income by 2022 when India celebrates its 75th year of independence. Our emphasis is on generating higher incomes for farmers. We consider agriculture as an enterprise and want to help the farmers to produce more from the same land parcel at lesser cost and simultaneously realize higher prices for their produce. Our emphasis is also on generating productive and gainful on-farm and non-farm employment for farmers and the landless families. अध्यक्ष महोदय, देश के किसानों के अथक परिश्रम का परिणाम है कि आज देश की कृषि उत्पादन रिकॉर्ड स्तर पर है. वर्ष 2016-17 में लगभग 275 मिलियन टन खाद्यान्न और लगभग 300 मिलियन टन फलों एवं सब्जियों का ऐतिहासिक उत्पादन हुआ है. अध्यक्ष महोदय, हमारे दल के घोषणा पत्र में ये संकल्प है कि कृषि को लाभदारी बनाने के लिए किसान भाइयों को उनकी लागत, उत्पादन की लागत से कम 50% से 50% से अधिक अर्थात लागत से 1.5 गुना दाम मिले। सरकार इस संकल्प के प्रति संवेदनशील रही है। रबी की अधिकांश अधिघोषित फसलों का न्यूनतम समर्थन मूल्य लागत से कम 1.5 गुना तय किया जा चुका है। अब हम बची हुई अधिघोषित फसलों के लिए भी इस संकल्प को एक सिद्धांत की तरह लागू करने का फैसला लिया है। मुझे ये घोषणा करते हुए अत्यंत प्रसन्नता का अनुभव हो रहा है कि तय किए गए सिद्धांत के अनुसार सरकार ने आगामी खरीफ की सभी अधिघोषित फसलों का न्यूनतम समर्थन मूल्य उत्पादन लागत से कम 1.5 गुना करने का फैसला ले लिया है। मेरा विश्वास है कि यह ऐतिहासिक निर्णय किसान भाइयों की आय दुगनी करने की दिशा में एक महत्वपूर्ण कदम साबित होगा। हमारी सरकार किसी भी विषय को टुकड़े टुकड़ों में नहीं वरना समग्रता के साथ सुलझाने की अप्रोच के साथ काम करती है। न्यूनतम समर्थन मूल्य बढ़ा देना ही पर्याप्त नहीं है, ये अधिक महत्वपूर्ण है कि घोषित MSP का पूरा लाभ किसानों को मिले। इसके लिए यह आवश्यक है कि यदि बाजार के दाम MSP से कम हो तो सरकार MSP की खरीदी करे या किसी अन्य व्यवस्था के अंतर्गत ये सुनिश्चित करे कि किसानों को पूरा MSP मिले। नीति आयोग केंद्र एवं राज्य सरकारों के साथ चर्चा कर एक पुख्ता व्यवस्था तैयार करेगा जिससे किसानों को उनकी फसल के उचित दाम दिलवाए जा सकेंगे। For better price realization, farmers need to make decisions based on prices likely to be available after its harvest. Government will create an institutional mechanism with participation of all concerned ministries to develop appropriate policies, practices for price and demand forecast, use of future and options market, expansion of warehouse depository system, and to take decisions about specific export and import related measures. Madam Speaker, last year I had announced the strengthening of the ENAM and to expand the coverage of the ENAM to 585 APMCs. 470 APMCs have been connected to ENAM network and the rest will be connected by March 2018. More than 86% of our farmers are small and marginal. They are not in a position to directly transact at APMCs and other wholesale markets. We will develop and upgrade existing 22,000 rural huts into Grameen agricultural markets. In these GRAMs, physical infrastructure will be strengthened by using MNREGA and other government schemes. These GRAMs, electronically linked to ENAMs, are exempted from regulations of the EPMCs and will provide farmers directly to make direct sale to consumers and bulk purchasers. An agri-market infrastructure fund with a corpus of rupees 2,000 crore will be set up for developing and upgrading the agricultural market infrastructure in the 22,000 Grameen agricultural markets and 585 APMCs. The task of connecting all eligible habitations with all weather roads has been substantially completed, and with the target date brought forward to March 2019 from March 2022. It is now time to strengthen and widen its ambit further to include major link routes which connect habitations to agricultural and rural markets, higher secondary schools and hospitals. The Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana Phase 3 will include such linkages. हम वर्षों से ये कहते रहे हैं कि भारत एक कृषि प्रधान देश है। जैसे भारत एक कृषि प्रधान देश है वैसे ही देश के जिले में किसी न किसी विशिष्ट कृषि उत्पादन की जाने जा सकते हैं, लेकिन हमने इस पर विशेष ध्यान अब तक नहीं दिया। जैसे उद्योग जगत में क्लस्टर बेस्ड विकास का मॉडल अपनाया गया है, वैसे ही हमारे जिलों में विशेष कृषि उत्पादन पदों चिन्हित पर उन्हें वैज्ञानिक तरीके से क्लस्टर मॉडल पर विकसित करने की आवश्यकता है। कल्टीवेशन ऑफ हॉर्टिकल्चर क्रॉप्स इन क्लस्टर्स brings advantages of scales of operations and can spur establishment of the entire chain of productions to marketing besides giving recognition to the districts for specific crops. The Ministry of Agriculture and Farmer Welfare will reorient the ongoing schemes and promote the cluster-based development of agri-commodities in regions in partnership with ministries of food processing, commerce and other allied ministries. Our government has promoted organic farming in a big way. Organic farming with farmer producer organizations and village producer organizations in large clusters of preferably 1,000 hectares each will be encouraged. Women self-help groups will also be encouraged to take up organic agriculture in clusters under the National Rural Livelihood Program. Our ecology supports cultivation of highly specialized medicinal and aromatic plants. India is also a home to a large number of small and cottage industries which manufacture perfumes, essential oils and other associated products. Our government shall support an organized cultivation of associate industries. I propose to allocate a sum of rupees 200 crores for this purpose. Food processing sector is growing at an average of 8% per annum. The Prime Minister's Krishi Sampada Yojana is our flagship program for boosting the investment in food processing. Allocation in the food processing ministry is being doubled from 715 crore in the RE for 17-18 to 1400 crore in 18-19. The government will promote the establishment of specialized agro-processing and financial institutions in this sector. Tomato, onion and potato are basic vegetables consumed throughout the year. However, seasonal and regional production of these perishable commodities poses a serious challenge in connecting farmers and consumers in a manner that satisfies both. My government proposes to launch an Operation Green on the lines of Operation Flood. Operation Green shall promote farmer producers organizations, agri-logistics, processing facilities and professional managements. I propose to allocate a sum of rupees 500 crores for this purpose. India's agri-export potential is as high as $100 billion against a current support export of rupees of $30 billion. To realize this potential, export of agri commodities will be liberalized. I also propose to set up a state-of-the-art facility in 42 mega food parks. I propose to I propose to extend the facility of Kisan credit cards to fisheries and animal husbandry farmers to help them to meet their working capital needs. Is vyavastha se chote aur simant kisano ko labh milega. Bamboo is green gold. We have removed bamboo grown outside the forest areas from the definition of trees. Now I propose to launch a restructured national bamboo mission with an outlay of rupees 1290 crores to promote bamboo sector in a holistic manner. Many farmers are installing solar water pumps to irrigate their fields. Generation of solar electricity is harvesting by sun by the farmers using their lands. Government will of India will take necessary measures to encourage the state governments to put in place a mechanism that their surplus solar power is purchased by distribution companies or licensees at reasonably remunerative prices. our government set up a long-term irrigation fund in NABARD for meeting the funding requirements of irrigation work. Scope of the fund would be expanded to cover specified command area in development areas. Last year, I had announced the setting up of the micro irrigation fund for facilitating expansion of coverage under the micro irrigation and dairy processing infrastructure development fund to help finance investment in dairy farming. It is now time to expand such focused investments. I now announce the setting up of a fishery and aquaculture infrastructure development fund of fisheries sector and an animal husbandry infrastructure fund for financing infrastructure requirement in the animal husbandry sector. The total corpus of these two funds would be rupees 10,000 crores. Our government has already steadily increasingly the volume of institutional credit for agricultural sector on a year to year from 8.5 lakh crores in 2014-15 to 10 lakh crores in 2017-18. I now propose to raise this amount to rupees 11 lakh crores for the year 2018-19. Presently, lessee cultivators are not able to avail crop loans. Consequently, a significant portion of the arable land remains hollow, and tenant cultivators are forced to secure credit from usurious money lenders. Niti Aayog, in consultation with the state governments, will evolve a suitable mechanism to enable the access of lessee cultivators to credit without compromising the rights of the landowners. Government will extend a favorable taxation treatment to farmer producer organizations for helping farmers to aggregate the needs of input farm services, processing and sales operation. I shall give the details of this in part B of my speech. Air pollution in the Delhi NCR region has been a cause of concern. A special scheme will be implemented to support the efforts of the government of Haryana, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh and NCT Delhi to address the air pollution and subsidize machinery required for an in-situ management of the crop residue. Adhyaksh Mahodaya, Desh ki Vartaman Sheesh Netritva, Garibi ko bahut kareeb se dekhkar Garibi ke में जीकर यहां तक पहुंचा है. SC ST वर्गों की, पिछड़ों की, आर्थिक रूप से कमजोर वर्गों की चिंताएं होती हैं, उन्हें भलीभांति परिचित हैं. गरीब और मध्यम वर्ग के लिए केस स्टडी नहीं, बल्कि वो खुद ही केस स्टडी हैं. पिछले 3 वर्षों से सरकार की योजनाएं का केंद्र गरीब रहा है, मध्यम वर्ग रहा है. ये सरकार गरीब की छोटी छोटी चिंताओं और बड़ी बड़ी समस्याओं को दूर करने के लिए लगातार कोशिश करती रही है. गरीब महिलाओं की लकड़ी के धुएं से मुक्ति के लिए मिले, इसके लिए प्रधानमंत्री जी ने उज्ज्वला योजना शुरू की थी. शुरुआत में 5 करोड़ गरीब महिलाओं को मुफ्त गैस कनेक्शन का लक्ष्य रखा था, लेकिन इस योजना की गति को देखकर महिलाओं इसकी लोकप्रियता को देखते हुए इसका लक्ष्य बढ़ाने जा रहे हैं. अब सरकार उज्ज्वला योजना के तहत 8 करोड़ गरीब महिलाओं को मुफ्त गैस कनेक्शन देगी. देश में हर गरीब के घर में रोशनी पहुंचे, इसके लिए सरकार द्वारा प्रधानमंत्री सौभाग्य योजना की शुरुआत की गई है. इस योजना के तहत देश के 4 करोड़ गरीब घरों को बिना कोई शुल्क के बिजली कनेक्शन से जोड़ा जा रहा है. इस योजना पर 16,000 करोड़ रुपए खर्च किए जा रहे हैं. घर का 1 घंटा बिजली ना हो तो हम लोग इधर उधर दौड़ने लगते हैं. टीवी कैसे चलेगा, मोबाइल कैसे चार्ज होगा, लैपटॉप का क्या होगा, ये सोचने लगते हैं. अब आप उन लोगों की सोचिए, उन महिलाओं, उन बच्चों के बारे में सोचिए जिनके घरों में अब बिजली पहुंचेगी तो किस तरह से जिंदगी प्रधानमंत्री सौभाग्य योजना बदलने जा रही है.
गरीब को सरकार के स्वच्छ भारत मिशन से बड़ा लाभ पहुंचा है। इस मिशन के तहत सरकार ने अब तक 6 करोड़ से ज्यादा शौचालयों का निर्माण कर चुकी है। इन शौचालयों का सकारात्मक प्रभाव नारी की गरिमा, बेटी की शिक्षा और पूरे परिवार के स्वास्थ्य सुरक्षा पर स्पष्ट रूप से पड़ा है। अगले वित्तीय वर्ष में हमारा लगभग 2 करोड़ शौचालय बनाने का लक्ष्य है। अध्यक्ष महोदया, गरीब की एक चिंता रही है सिर के ऊपर अदद छत की। भ्रष्टाचार करके जुटाई गई बेईमानी संपत्ति से दूर गरीब को बस ईमानदारी की कमाई से एक छत, एक छोटा सा मकान चाहता है। गरीब अपने घर का सपना पूरा कर सके, इसके लिए हमारी सरकार उसकी पूरी मदद कर रही है। हमने लक्ष्य रखा है कि 2022 तक देश के हर गरीब के पास उसका अपना घर हो। इससे लिए ग्रामीण और शहरी इलाकों में प्रधानमंत्री आवास योजना शुरू की गई है। प्रधानमंत्री आवास योजना ग्रामीण के तहत 2017-18 में 51 लाख और वर्ष 2018-19 में 51 लाख यानी 1 करोड़ से ज़्यादा सिर्फ ग्रामीण इलाकों में बनाए जा रहे हैं। शहरी क्षेत्रों में 37 लाख मकान बनाने के लिए मदद स्वीकृत की गई है। माई गवर्नमेंट विल ऑल्सो इस्टेब्लिश अ डेडिकेटेड अफोर्डेबल हाउसिंग फंड इन द नेशनल हाउसिंग बैंक फंडेड फ्रॉम प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर लेंडिंग शॉर्टफॉल इन फुली सर्विस बॉन्ड्स ऑथराइज बाई द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया। लोन्स टू सेल्फ हेल्प ग्रुप्स ऑफ वुमेन increased to about 42,000 crores in 16-17, growing 37% over the previous year. The government is confident that the loans to the self-help groups will increase to 75,000 crores by March 2019. I propose to substantially increase the allocation to the National Livelihood Mission to ₹5,750 crores in 2018-19. ग्राउंड वाटर इरीगेशन स्कीम अंडर द प्रधान प्राइम मिनिस्टर्स कृषि सिंचाई योजना हर खेत को पानी विल बी टेकन अप इन द 96 डिप्राइव्ड इरीगेशन डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स विच वेयर लेस देन 30% ऑफ द लैंड होल्डिंग गेट्स अशोर्ड इरीगेशन प्रेजेंटली। आई हैव एलोकेटेड ₹2,600 crores फॉर दिस। As my proposals outlined above indicate, the focus of the government next year will be to provide a maximum livelihood opportunities in the rural areas by spending more on livelihood, agricultural and allied activities and construction of rural infrastructure. In the year 2018-19, for creation of livelihood and infrastructure in rural areas, a total amount to be spent by ministries will be ₹14.34 lakh crores from extra budgetary and non-budgetary resources of ₹11.98 lakh crores. Apart from employment due to farming activities and self-employment, this expenditure will create 321 crore person days, 3.17 lakh kilometers of rural roads, 51 lakh new rural houses, 1.88 crore toilets, and provide 1.75 crore new household electricity connections besides boosting agriculture. Details are given in Annexure 1 of this speech. Health, education, and social protection. My government's goal is to assist and provide opportunity to every Indian to realize her full potential, capable of achieving her economic social dreams. Our government is implementing a comprehensive social security and protection program to reach every household of old widows, orphan children, divyang and deprived as the socio-economic caste census allocation of National Social Assistance Program has been kept at ₹9,975. We have managed to get children to school, but the quality of education is still a cause of concern. We have now defined learning outcomes of a national survey of more than 20 lakh children has been conducted to assess the status on the ground. This will help in devising a district-wide strategy for improving the quality of education. We now propose to treat education holistically without segmentation from pre-nursery to class 12. Improvement in the quality of teachers can improve the quality of education in the country. We will initiate an integrated B.Ed. program for teachers, training of teachers during the service is extremely critical. We have amended the Right to Education Act to enable more than 13 lakh untrained teachers to get trained. Technology will be the biggest driver in improving the quality of education. We propose to increase the digital intensity in education and move gradually from blackboard to digital board. Technology will also be used to upgrade the skills of teachers through the recently launched digital portal Diksha. The government is committed to provide the best quality education to the tribal children in their own environment. To realize this, it has been decided that by the year 2022, every block with more than 50% scheduled tribe population and at least 20,000 tribal people will have an Ekalya model residential school. Eklavya school will be on par with the Navodaya Vidyalayas and will have special facilities for preserving local art and culture besides providing training in sports and skill development. To set up investment in research and related infrastructure of premier institutions, including health institutions, I propose to launch a major initiative called the Revitalizing of Infrastructure and Systems in Education, RISE by 2022, with a total investment of rupees 1 lakh crore in the next 4 years. Higher Education Financing Agency would be suitably structured for funding this initiative. Our government had taken up the major initiative for setting up an institute of eminence. There has been a tremendous response to this initiative by institutions in both public and private sector. We have received more than 100 applications. We have taken steps to set up a specialized railway university at Vadodara. We propose to set up 2 new full-fledged schools of planning and architectures to be selected on a challenge mode. Additionally, 18 new schools of planning and architecture would be established in the IITs and the NITs as autonomous schools, also on a challenge basis. The government would also launch the Prime Minister's Research Fellows scheme this year. Under this scheme, we would identify 1,000 best BTEC students each year from premier institutions and provide them with facilities to do PhDs in the IITs and the Indian Institute of Science with a handsome fellowship. It is expected that these bright young fellows would voluntarily commit few hours every week for teaching in a higher educational institution. Now I come to the health sector. Sarve Bhavantu Sukhina, Sarve Santu Niramaya is the guiding principle of my government. Only Swasth Bharat can be Smridh Bharat. India cannot realize its demographic dividend without its citizens being healthy. I am pleased to announce 2 major initiatives as a part of the Ayushman Bharat program aimed at path-breaking interventions to address the health holistically in primary, secondary and tertiary care systems covering both prevention and health promotion. The National Health Policy 2017 has envisioned that health and wellness centers as the foundation of India's health system. These 1.5 lakh centers will bring healthcare system closer to the homes of the people. These centers will provide a comprehensive healthcare, including a non-communicable diseases and maternal and child services. These centers will also provide free essential drugs and diagnostic services. I am committing rupees 1200 crores in this budget for this flagship program. I am also invite contribution from the private sector through the CSR and the philanthropic institutions in adopting these centers. Madam Speaker, we are all aware that lakhs of families in our country have to borrow or sell assets to receive indoor treatment in hospitals. Government is seriously concerned about the impoverishment of the poor and the vulnerable families. Presently, the Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana provides an annual coverage of only rupees 30,000 to poor families. Several state governments have also implemented and supplemented health protection schemes by providing varying coverages. My government has now decided to take healthcare protection to a new aspirational level. Madam, this is important. We are now launching a flagship national health protection scheme to cover 10 crore poor and vulnerable families. This is approximately 50 crore beneficiaries. By providing them up to 5 lakh rupees per family per year for secondary and tertiary care hospitalization. This will be the world's largest government-funded healthcare program. Adequate funds will be provided for smooth implementation of this program. Madam Speaker, Madam, 10 करोड़ परिवार यानी 50 करोड़ लोगों को 5 लाख रुपए प्रतिवर्ष हॉस्पिटलाइजेशन की सुविधा ये सरकार उपलब्ध करवाएगी। Madam Speaker, these two far-reaching initiatives under Ayushman Bharat program will build a new India 2022 and ensure enhanced productivity, well-being and avert wage loss and impoverishment. These schemes will also generate lakhs of jobs, particularly for women. The government is steadily but surely progressing towards the goal of universal health coverage. यानी कि इस 50 करोड़ की जो सुविधा है उसको आगे भी एक्सपेंड किया जाएगा इस एक्सपेरिमेंट को देखने के बाद. Tuberculosis claims more lives every year than any other infectious disease. It affects mainly poor and malnourished people. My government has therefore decided to allocate rupees 600 crores to provide nutritional support to all TB patients at a rate of rupees 500 per month for the duration of their treatment. In order to further enhance accessibility of quality medical education and healthcare, we'll be setting up 24 new government medical colleges and hospitals by upgrading existing district colleges in the country, district hospitals in the country. This would ensure at least one medical college for every 3 parliamentary constituencies and at least one government medical college in each state in the country. Our resolve of making our villages open defecation free is aimed at improving the quality of life of our villages. We will launch a scheme called for galvanizing organic bio-agro resources dhan, gobar dhan, for management and conversion of cattle dung and solid waste in farm to compost, fertilizer, biogas and bio-CNG. The Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Bima Yojana has benefited 5.22 crore families with life insurance cover of 2 lakhs on payment of premium of rupees 330 per annum. Likewise, under the Prime Minister's Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana, 13 crore 25 lakh people have been insured with personal accident cover of rupees 2 lakhs on payment of a premium of only rupees 12 per annum. The government will work to cover all poor households, including scheduled caste, scheduled tribe households, under these in a mission mode. The government will expand the coverage under the Pradhan Mantri Jan Dhan Yojana by bringing all the 60 crore bank accounts within its fold and undertake measures to provide services of micro insurance and unorganized sector pension schemes through these accounts. Our commitment towards Beti Bachao, Beti Padhao is unflinching. Sukanya Smriti account scheme launched in January 2015 has been a great success. Until November 2017, more than 1.26 crore accounts have been opened across the country in the name of the girl child, securing an amount of rupees 19,183. Cleaning of Ganga is an important is of national importance, and it is our firm commitment that members will be happy to learn that the work is gathered speed. A total of 187 projects have been sanctioned under the Namami Gange program for infrastructure development and river surface cleaning, rural sanitation and other interventions at a cost of rupees 16,713 crores. 47 projects have been completed and the remaining projects are at the various stages of execution. All 4,465 Ganga Gram villages on the banks of the river have been declared open defecation free. To give focused attention and to achieve our vision of an inclusive society, the government has identified 115 aspirational districts taking various indices of the development in consideration. The government aims at improving the quality of life in these districts by investing in social services like health, education, nutrition, skill upgradation, financial inclusion, infrastructure like irrigation, rural electrification, potable drinking water, and access to toilets at an accelerated pace and in a time-bound manner. We expect these 115 districts to become a model of development. Economic and social advancement of hard-working people of scheduled castes and scheduled tribes has received care and attention. Our government has increased a total earmarked allocation in the SCs in the 279 programs from rupees 34,334 in 16-17 to 52,719 in 17-18. Likewise, for STs, the earmarked allocation was increased from rupees 21,811 in 16-17 to 32,508 in the RE in 17-18 in the 305 programs. I propose to the earmarked allocation of 56,619 crore for SCs and 39,135 crore for STs in the BE of 2018-19. Government estimated schematic budgetary expenditure on health, education and social protection for 18-19 at 1.38 lakh crores against an estimated expenditure of 1.22 lakh crores in the BE of 17-18. Details are given in this expenditure. The expenditure is likely to go up by at least 15,000 crores in 18-19 on account of the additional allocations during the year and the extra budgetary expenditure, including through the higher education financing agencies itself. MSME and employment. Medium, small and micro enterprises are a major engine of growth and employment. I have provided rupees 3,794 crores to the MSME sector for credit support, capital and interest subsidy on innovations. Mass formalization of business of MSMEs is taking place in the countries after the demonetization and the introduction of the GST. This is generating an enormous amount of financial information database of the MSME business and the finances.
This big database will be used for improving the financing of the MSMEs and the requirement including the working capital. It is proposed to onboard public sector banks and corporates on the trade electronic receivable discounting system platform and link this with the GSTN. Online loan sanctioning facilities for MSMEs will be revamped for prompt decision making by the banks. Government will soon announce measures to effectively address the non-performing assets and the stressed accounts of the MSMEs. There will be this will enable a larger financing of MSMEs and also considerably ease the cash flow challenges faced by them. In order to reduce the tax burden on the MSMEs and to create a large number of jobs, I will be announcing some measures in Part B of my speech. The Mudra Yojana launched in April 2015 has led to a sanction of rupees 4.6 lakh crore in credit to some 10.38 crore Mudra loans. 76% of the loan accounts are of women and more than 50% belong to Scheduled Caste, Scheduled Tribe and OBCs. It is proposed to set up a target of rupees 3 lakh crores for lending and Mudra under 2018-19 and having successfully exceeded the targets in the previous term. The non-banking financial companies stepped up financing of the MSMEs after demonetizations. MSMEs can become a very powerful vehicle for delivering the loans under Mudra. Refinancing policy and eligibility criteria set up by the Mudra will be reviewed for better refinancing of the MSMEs. Use of fintech in financial space will help the growth of the MSMEs. A group of in the Ministry of Finance is examining the policy and the institutional development measures needed for creating the right environment in the fintech companies to grow in India. Venture capital funds and angel investors need an innovative and special development and regulatory regime in their growth. We have taken a number of policy decisions, including launching of the Startup in India program, building a very robust alternative investment regime in the country, and rolling out a taxation regime designed for the special nature of the VCFs and the angel investors. We will take additional measures to strengthen the environment for their growth and successful operation of the alternative investment fund in India. Creation of job opportunities and facilitating generation of employment has been at the core of the policy planning. During the last 3 years, we have taken a number of steps to boost employment and generation in the country. These measures include contribution of 8.33% of the EPF for new employees by the government for 3 years, contribution of 12% to EPF of new employees of 3 years by government sector, employing large number of people such as people like textile, leather and footwear, additional deduction to employees of 30% of wages paid for employees under the Income Tax Act, launch of National Apprentice Scheme and stipend and support and sharing of the cost of the basic training by the government to give training to 50 lakh youth by 2020, introduction system of fixed term employment for apparel and footwear industry, increasing paid maternity leave from 12 weeks to 26 weeks along with the provision for creches. These measures have started showing results. An independent study conducted recently has shown 70 lakh formal jobs being created in this year. To carry forward the momentum, I am happy to announce that the government will contribute 12% of the wages of new employees in EPF for all sectors for the next 3 years. Also, the facility of fixed term employment will be extended to all sectors. To incentivize employment for more women in the formal sector and to enable higher take-home wages, I propose to make an amendment to the Employees Provident Fund and Miscellaneous Provision Act to reduce women contribution to 8% for the first 3 years of their employment, as against 12% or 10%, with no changes to the employer's contribution. The government is setting up a model aspirational skill center in every district in the country under the Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendra program. 306 Pradhan Mantri Kaushal Kendras have been established for imparting skill training through these centers. The government has approved a comprehensive textile package of rupees 6,000 crores in 2016 to boost the apparel and made-up segments. I now propose an outlay of rupees 7,148 for the textile sector in 2018 and 2019. Infrastructure and financial sector development. Infrastructure is the growth driver of the economy. Our country needs massive investment, estimated to be in excess of 50 lakh crores in infrastructure, to increase growth of GDP, connect and integrate the nation with a network of roads, airports, railways, ports, inland water, and to provide good quality services to the people. We have made an all-time high allocation in rail and road sector. We have committed to further enhancing public investment. Provision of key linkages like coal for power, power for railways, and railway rakes for coal have been rationalized and made very efficient. Prime Minister personally reviews the targets and the achievements in infrastructure sectors on a regular basis. Using online monitoring system of Pragati alone, projects worth rupees 9.46 lakh crores have been facilitated and fast-tracked. To secure India's defense, we are developing connectivity infrastructure in the border areas. Rohtang tunnel has been completed to provide all-weather connectivity to the Ladakh region. Contract for the construction of the Jozila Pass tunnel of more than 14 kilometers is progressing well. I now propose to take up the construction of a tunnel under the Sela Pass. For promoting tourism and emergency medical care, government will make necessary framework for encouraging investment in the seaplane activities. Urbanization is our opportunity and priority. My government has rolled out two interlinked programs, Smart City Mission and the Amrut. Smart City Mission aims at creating 100 smart cities and state-of-art amenities. I am happy to inform that 99 cities have been selected with an outlay of rupees 2.04 lakh crores. These cities have started implementing various projects like Smart City Command Control Center, Smart Roads, Smart Solar Roof, Intelligent Transport Systems, Smart Parks. Projects worth rupees 2,350 crores have been completed, and work of rupees 20,852 crores has been under progress. To preserve and revitalize the soul of the heritage cities of India, National Heritage City Development Augmentation Yojana has been taken up in a major way. India is blessed with an abundance of tourist attractions. It is proposed to develop 10 prominent tourist sites into iconic tourism destinations by following an holistic approach involving infrastructure and skill development, development of technology, attracting private investment, branding and marketing. In addition, tourist amenities at 110 Adarsh monuments in the Archaeological Survey of India will be upgraded to an enhanced visitor experience. The Amrut program focuses on providing water supply to all households in 500 cities. State level plans of rupees 77,640 crores for 500 cities has been approved. Water supply contracts for 494 projects worth rupees 19,428 crores and sewage work contracts for rupees 272 projects costing rupees 12,429 crores has been awarded. Reforms have been catalyzed by these missions.
482 cities have started credit ratings. 142 cities have got investment grade ratings. My ministry will leverage the India Infrastructure Finance Corporation to help finance major infrastructure projects, including investment in education, health infrastructure, or strategic and larger societal benefit considerations. The government has scaled new heights in the development of the road infrastructure. We are confident to complete the national highways exceeding 9,000 kilometers during 2017 and 18. The ambitious Bharatmala project has been approved for providing seamless connectivity of interior and backward areas and borders of the country to develop 35,000 kilometers in phase one at an estimated cost of 5,35,000 crores to raise equity from the market for its mature road assets. NHAI will consider organizing the road assets into a special purpose vehicle and use the innovative mobilization structures like toll operate and transfer and infrastructure investment funds. Strengthening the railway networks and enhancing railways carrying capacity has been a major focus of the government. Railway capex for the year 2018-19 has been pegged at ₹1,48,528 crores. A large part of the capex is devoted to its capacity creation. 18,000 kilometers of doubling and third and fourth line works of 5,000 kilometers of gauge conversion would eliminate capacity constraints and transform almost the entire network into broad gauge. There are also significant movement in the achievement of the physical target of the railways itself. We are moving fast towards optimal electrification of railway network. 4,000 kilometers targeted for commissioning during 2017-18. Work on eastern and western dedicated freight corridor is also in full swing. Adequate number of rolling stock, 12,000 wagons, 5,160 coaches, and approximately 700 locomotives are being produced during the year 2018-19. A major program has been initiated to strengthen the infrastructure goods shed and fast track commissioning of the private buildings. A safety first policy with allocation of adequate funds under the Rashtriya Railway Sanrakshana Kosh is a cornerstone of the railways. Focus on safety. Maintenance of track infrastructure is being given special attention. Over 3,600 kilometers of track renewal is targeted during the current year. Other major steps include increasing use of technology, fog safe, train protection and warning system. A decision has been taken to eliminate 4,267 unmanned railway crossings in the broad gauge network in the next 2 years. Redevelopment of 600 major railway stations is being taken up by the Indian Railway Station Development Company Limited. All stations with more than 25,000 footfalls will have escalators. All railway stations and trains will be progressively provided with Wi-Fi, CCTVs, and will also provide at all station and on trains to enhance security passengers. Modern train sets with state-of-art amenities and features are being designed at the integrated coach factory, Perambur. First such train set will be commissioned during 2018-19. The Mumbai transport system, which is the lifeline of the city, is being expanded and augmented to add 90 kilometers of double line track at a cost of ₹11,000 crores. 150 kilometers of additional suburban network is being planned at a cost of ₹40,000 crores, including elevated corridors in some sections. A suburban network of approximately 160 kilometers is also being at an estimated cost of ₹17,000 crores is being planned to cater to the growth of the Bengaluru metropolitan. foundation of the Mumbai-Ahmedabad bullet train project, India's first high-speed rail project, was laid on September 14, 2017. An institute is coming up at Vadodara to train the manpower required for the high-speed railway project. For the first 3 years, the domestic air passenger traffic grew at 18%, and our airline companies placed orders for more than 900 aircrafts. Regional connectivity scheme, Udaan, initiated by the Government of India last year, shall connect 56 unserved airports and 31 unserved helipads in the country. Operations have already started at 16 such airports. सरकार की इस पहल से हवाई चप्पल पहनने वाले नागरिक भी अब हवाई जहाज की यात्रा कर सकते हैं। एयरपोर्ट अथॉरिटी ऑफ इंडिया नाउ हैज 124 एयरपोर्ट्स। वी प्रपोज टू एक्सपैंड आवर एयरपोर्ट कैपेसिटी मोर देन 5 टाइम्स टू हैंडल 1 बिलियन ट्रिप्स अ ईयर अंडर द न्यू इनिशिएटिव। नवनिर्माण बैलेंस शीट ऑफ Airport Authority of India shall be leveraged to raise more resources for funding and expansion. Our efforts to set up a coalition on the disaster resilient infrastructure for developing international good practice appropriate standard and regulatory mechanism for resilient infrastructure development is moving well. I propose to allocate 60 crores for kickstarting the initiative. The government and the market regulators will then have taken necessary measures for developing and monetizing vehicles like the Infrastructure Investment Fund and the Real Estate Investment Fund. The government of India would monetize select CPSC SEs using the InvITs from next year. In the current year, we included in the scope of harmonized list of infrastructure, ropeways to promote tourism, logistic parks, and expanded the scope of railway infrastructure to include development of commercial land around the railway station. The Reserve Bank of India has issued guidelines to nudge corporates to access the bond market. SEBI will also consider mandating, beginning with large corporates, to meet about 1/4 of their financing needs from the bond market. Corporate bonds rated at BBB or equivalent are investment grade. In India, most regulators permit bonds with the AA rating only as eligible for investment. It is now to move from AA to A grade ratings. The government has and the concerned regulators will take necessary action.